I was brought here to tell, well, I guess at first I need to tell you a little bit about me. So I'm actually originally from South Carolina. I grew up in a small rural town in South Carolina, and then I went and did my BS at a school about 30 minutes away from my hometown, which is actually a lot for me because I didn't leave South Carolina until I was a junior in college. I didn't fly until I was a junior in college. And the first trip outside of South Carolina is when I went to University of Alabama for a summer undergraduate research program. And even in that, I was forced to leave. They forced me to apply for the summer research opportunities, and I got two of them. I got one from Clemson, which is also in South Carolina, and then I got one from University of Alabama in Tuscaloosa. And they told me I couldn't go to the one in Clemson, so I had to go to Alabama. So what happened, Alabama called, and my parents put me on gave me a bus ticket, and put all my stuff onto the bus, and then the next morning, I was in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. And it was the best thing that ever happened to me. So I got off the bus. It was great that someone had a sign that was saying that, you know, for Toby, because otherwise I'd have been lost. And from then on, it was great. And another thing that you need to know is that I was supposed to be there a week earlier. But what happened in terms of finances didn't work out, and I didn't think I was going to be able to go. So when Tuscaloosa called me, they called my parents' house, but I was actually in the woods. I was actually actually slaughtering a pig, which I've never done before. Okay, and I saw my parents coming to get me, and they said that Tuscaloosa called, and they said that we're going to put you on a bus to go to Tuscaloosa. And I said, I'm not going to Tuscaloosa. And then the next morning, I was on the bus, and I got. So we're here about networking with professors. So the first thing, why is this important? So why is this important is because this is for you. So if I know more about you, whenever it's time for a recommendation letter, it makes it really, really easy for me to write a recommendation letter. So remember, recommendation letters, really, you're gonna be writing it for me, right? So whatever you do and whatever interaction we have, it makes it really easy for me to write it. Right, you want me to be able to sit down and be happy to write. That's what you want. We also talked about what's the difference between a recommendation letter from someone in student services versus one from a professor. So remember that if you are in a certain division, a specific department, it's great for me to have a recommendation. You have a recommendation from me, mainly because I'm gonna tell you about what you can do in that profession, okay? And another thing I wanna do, and I didn't do this before, This is not a lecture, okay? And I want you to make sure, Justin,
yes,
I want
sir.
You to make sure that I'm not lecturing, because gotcha. That's not what I want. What I want is I wanna give you some information, and I want you to ask questions, because this is for you. I lecture 2 days a week, and I'm done, okay? Here I came here to basically help you. So I want you to be open and ask the question that you really need to be answered from someone like me. Okay? So you don't want to facilitate this, please?
Facilitate. We can start out. You are right on topic with the letters of recommendation. Actually, I was talking, this is Janice right here. I don't know if you've met Janice. Janice, Dr. Nelson, this is Janice. Sure. All right. She is just applied for one of our SWASAP regional scholarships, and we were just talking before you arrived about the difference between kind of a TRIO scholarship and more of a job reference or graduate school program type reference. And TRIO, you know, we're going to tell the stories,
right?
But as you indicated, it's about where you come in is more what you can do, what they can accomplish in the field,
right,
in which they're trying to get to. How do they go about developing that relationship?
So developing that relationship can come in a variety of different ways. One, If you're in my course, any course that you see a professor that you want to have a better relationship with, the first thing is to actually go up to that professor after class. Go up to that professor after class and actually have something you want to talk to them about. And I'll tell you one thing you need to do is go to their website and find out what they're interested in. Because we're humans, right? And it doesn't matter what relationship you're in, if you find out something about them, and they would tell you everything about it. That's just how humans are, right? So if you said, okay, this person likes basketball, and you know some stuff about basketball, you all of a sudden that person will be talking about basketball with you, or just talking, period. Okay? So go to their website, find out what they're researching, because you may actually have some interest in that, right? You have some interest in that. When you go to that professor, I can see that you have been working in this area, I'm interested in working in the area. Can we have a meeting, okay? And then another way to get to contact the professor is this, okay? And I did this yesterday. I get these emails from students that says, I want to meet you, okay? And guess what I do with that email? I don't respond. I do not respond. You know why I don't respond? I'm not your friend. That's a text message that you sent to your friend. Right? That's a text message that you sent to your friend. You don't even have the respect for me to even say my name. Okay? So this is how you're gonna send an email to a professor. You're gonna say, dear doctor, or you can say doctor or professor so-and-so. Period. You're gonna have a body. This is what you're going to be requesting from me, okay? Either it means you are requesting a recommendation letter, if you're requesting to have a meeting with me, this is what you do for every professor, every email you send a professor, this is what you got to do. And then you have to end with something, yeah, I don't know what I write best, parentheses, and then your name. This is how you send an email. Not just to me, every professor at this university, and every professor you deal with. This is how you send an email. And this is not just in the university style. This is every email you send to anyone, okay? It's just like a letter. This is what I want to see. The first thing I see, when I see this right here, I see that this person took the time out to really write me something. And I actually really read this, okay? Do not misspell my name. I get that all the time. You can copy and paste names. There's no way you should misspell my name. I mean, it just isn't any way. You can copy and paste that, okay? Is that clear? Okay, this is how you do it. So don't say you don't know how to do it. And teach your friends, please, okay? So I get this and I'm like, You was walking to class and you sent this email from your mobile phone and you want me to respond and I have 100 emails in my mailbox. And I'm an assistant professor. I'm not a social professor, I'm an assistant professor. I got 100 emails. And you are saying, I want to have a meeting. And there's 132 people in my class. Okay? And I'm the professor, I like my students and I want them to do good. But they still need to understand this is the proper way you do this. Why? Is that we have to prepare you for the future. I want you to get a job. That's what we're here for. I want you to get a job, if you want one. Okay? I can't get you a job if you don't want one. Okay, so I hope that I went off subject, so I'm going to stop myself. Go ahead. What else?
I really want to ask the students this. How many of you, okay, so I know I've sat down with some of my students and we've done our individual plan of action. And those of you who I have yet to meet with, that's what we're going to do the very first meeting. We're going to create our plan of action for what's remaining in this semester. I have started to make it a staple as one of the goals that we're going to do is go meet or go to your professor's office hours, okay? We're gonna figure out how to do that. How many of you have done that? so far? Oh, I'm impressed.
I'm impressed.
I really am. I mean, because how many of you are...
How many students of my 135 come to my office?
How many?
10.
And ask me how many of them already have an 8.
Pays off, right?
These are the people, even if they didn't come to my office hours, they're going to make an 8. But they have decided that they're going to come to my office hours anyway. You see what I'm saying? And I want the people that have a C and they want an 8. I want those people to come to my office. Why? Because they get connected to the people that already have an 8. And they should be staying with those people. Because guess what? I'm in front of the class, but when you leave my office hours, you're on your own, right? These are the people you should be studying with. And this is how after you leave here works. Because all of you are going to be working in groups. It doesn't matter what profession you're in. It's very small professions these days where you're going to be working not in groups at some point. So you have to build these connections now.
How many of you were intimidated to go to your professor's office hours?
I was.
Yeah, I know I was.
I was.
Tori's the only honest one here. She had her hand.
maybe just for big classes. Maybe because it depends who the professor is.
What's a big class?
Like right now I'm in organic chemistry. He comes off really rough and I don't want to go to his office hours and he's you just gotta see how he is.
I know who he is.
Okay, well he just comes off really rough, so I don't know.
Do you want
it's a lot of stuff.
Do you want to do well?
Yeah.
Have you already paid him?
Okay, so
Think about it like this. I am already paid. You have already paid me, okay? And I give you office hours, and you don't want to take advantage of, and you paid me a lot of money. I mean, you don't, and actually all that money you paid, I only get a very small fraction of it, right? Go get your money's worth. Mm-hmm. Let's think about it like that. Go get your money's worth. Don't worry about who they are or whatever. Go get your money's worth.
So it's not selfish if you kind of turn their office hours into like tutoring hours, because what if they don't want you to sit in there for their whole say they had it from
have you have you gone
o'clock.
And even see what it is? Have you tried it out? Have you tested out? You can't. So I'm a scientist. You can't give me a result unless you test it out at least 3 times. I need 3 data points. You give me 3 data points, and if that doesn't make a line, then you can say this is not going to work and you need to find other options. Okay? You need 3 data points. You can't go 1 day. It could be, you know, could be something going on. You know, I have bad days. Today was a bad day. My car, I went to the gym, came back from the gym, my car didn't start because I didn't have gas in it. Okay? So I had to walk to the gas station from my house and put gas in my car. Do you think that was nice? Actually, it was pretty nice. It was a nice day, and I got back. And I talked to him. So me, my wife, and my son get in the car, and the car doesn't crank. And I wanted to get a haircut for this, and I didn't get one. I was very upset. I had to get out of the car, walk to the gas station, and get that. Okay, so we have bad days. I didn't mean to get off touch. I'm so sorry. I didn't mean, but we have bad days. So you have to give me 3 data points. Especially me. You gotta give me 3 data points. Because one day you may give me and it's like it's just a bad day. Okay? So try it out. Okay? Remember, it's not about that person, it's about you getting what you want to get. Really? You pay for it.
So what if you go to like office hours and they talk like over your head every time? And you go to class and they talk over your head every time. And what I mean by talking over your head is like trying to explain something in terms that you don't understand, you ask them to explain it again, it's just like the same thing over and over again. That's my problem.
Okay, what class?
Chemistry 13-14.
Okay, chemistry 13-14, and I already know who you have. Okay? So what I want you to do is one thing we're trying to link up with with you and some tutors. So that's one thing we're trying to get that done.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
The other thing you need to do is you need to find a TA who's already been paid that is good and that can break it down into your level, because we have tons of TAs. And if you know one of your friends who have a good TA, just go over to them, because all the TAs have office hours. Find their office hours and go there. And remember, for organic, there is office hours for organic. You should be sitting in that room. If you don't know what it is, I'll tell you. You should be sitting in that room all times, right? Waiting for TAs to come in, because they already paid. That's what you need to do. Sit in there, get the best person, and they'll help you out. And they can break it down. But I used to do that. Is that helpful? Okay. Yeah, you have that. You will. We can't do it with some people. Everyone is not a good teacher. We just talked about some facts there.
How many of you actually, like Dr. Nelson brought up, actually emailed your professor beforehand? Or did you just go, okay? All right? Did you request? How many of you did email in the proper format to Dr. Nelson? Okay.
Good.
I'm impressed. Did you get a favorable response? Most of the time? No? Okay. Yeah. Okay.
So do you agree? This works. Okay.
Good.
I say good morning.
Me too. I say, I hope you're having a wonderful day.
Me too. I did have the
end. Or something like that. Because it just makes people feel good. You can get a lot out of a person if you make them feel good. That's just us being human. There's only a very small amount of people that doesn't work with. And there are some.
Anybody want to share a difficult experience with a professor? Because, like Dr. Nelson mentioned, they're not person, we're all human, we're not all going to match personalities, and, okay?
Well, my prompt one professor, like, he's like one of those people that...
Wow, she's giving me
exactly. Yeah.
You don't have to do that, but...
Okay, well...
Everyone forgive everything she said except for professor.
Okay. Well, one of my professors, he's one of those people who, like, he'll talk and talk, and when you ask a question, he kind of gets upset because you're interrupting him, and so he kind of feels like you're disturbing him in a way.
In class?
Yeah, in
class. How is it if you ask that question after class?
When I ask him after class, he's a little bit better about it, but then he kind of makes you feel like you're dumb when you, like, ask. He's like, he makes people feel dumb, so a lot of people don't ask him questions anymore.
Keep asking. You paid for it. Keep asking. Don't worry about how he makes you feel. Just keep going. I'm serious. Because you don't want to give up because you got some resistance. Maybe that's what they're doing. Don't give in. Just keep going. And eventually you're going to get what you want. Because that's what it's about, right?
My professor keeps
throwing
my name
on me. I've done it a few times. That's because whatever I copied, spell check changed, and that has happened to me. And then I apologize. And so yes, I don't know how to address that.
Dr. Nelson, could you just, because you do have such similar backgrounds to so many of our students, how did relay a little bit more in depth on how you got connected to your path of graduate school and...
Okay, so how many of you think that I knew what a professor was before I went to college? Virginia, do you think I knew? I had no idea. What happened for me is I never had a visit to my university. So what happened, we drove up, my mother dropped me off, and she says, do good. And then I walked into the university. Because I'm the first in my family to go to college, and the first one to get a degree. And I had to really survive on my own existence. That's just the truth of it. And I wanted to be a carpenter. You know, I wanted to be a carpenter, you know, build things, you know. And so I took building construction as a junior in high school, and I realized that I can do all the measurements, but I couldn't cut anything straight. And if you know that as a carpenter, you need for things to be, you know, lined correctly, right? So I was like, well, okay, this is not for me. I need to decide to do something else. So what else am I good at? Well, okay, I wish I would have known. I probably could be on the stock market now and doing being a mathematician there and making tons of money, but that, okay. Next best thing is chemistry. So I wanted to go to college, so I decided to go to my chemistry teacher. My chemistry teacher went to Francis Mary, and guess what? That's where I went. And that's really what happened. So I did research as an undergraduate. Sophomore year, did a research program. The reason why I was able to leave South Carolina is because I did a research program, went to Alabama, we talked about earlier. When I got back from Alabama, I was a changed person in a lot of ways. And that semester, that was my senior year, I flew to New Orleans, got on the plane for the first time, flew to New Orleans, presented two posters, one for Alabama, one from the research at Francis Marion. And this leads me to something else I need to talk about. Okay, can I switch?
Absolutely.
I'm switching because why having a relationship with a professor is good. Okay, I have never interviewed for any position except for one, this position. This is the first interview I've interviewed for. So when I got a job at IRIX after I got my BS, they called IRIX Pharmaceuticals, called my university and asked them for some people, and they gave them my name, because they knew who I was. When I did a postdoc at Carnegie Mellon, it's kind of like a training for being a professor. I never got the job. I basically got the job as a sophomore, as a second year graduate student. He was about 5 years in grad school. And he gave me the job. I don't know why, but he did. And then I went there and I had a job for them. So I've never interviewed. And it's all connected because of my networking with my undergraduate university and the graduate university. It's warm in here.
It's very warm, yeah.
Okay, so now, do you have any more for me? Because I have some.
Go.
Okay.
Go, yeah.
Let's talk about some real questions. Okay? So what are some real questions you have? Anything. Seriously. And not me as just being an organic professor, because people hate organic professors, that type of stuff. Just me being a professor, yes. Or just me being, you know, minority. Yes.
I have a question. So, like, I'm a sophomore right now, and last year I visited my professor and stuff like that. So, like, should you advise to visit more professors, like, in my field? Like, when I'm, like, a junior or senior, or should I start now?
You should start as early as possible, because when opportunities come up, opportunities for research. So there is the Wentz, and there is the Niblock. I can't remember the amounts, but I think they're $5,000. This $5,000 to do research, and that goes right in your pocket. There is travel to conferences. You don't think that's a lot of money? I think. How you doing, sir? You don't think that's a lot of money? I'm talking about one year. Okay. So you can get travel to conferences. With this situation, I was able to go to Japan. I've been to Copenhagen. I've been in lots of places. I would never have been able to do that without this. There's also departmental fellowships and scholarships that you get. And sometimes it's specific. And so you may be the only person that fits the criteria. But if they don't know you exist, then you're not going to get it. Does that make sense? And so, you know, you need to be thinking about this. There's also not just departmental, there is college. And the reason why I'm telling you this is that I'm on the committee. Hint, hint.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay, so I'm doing a research assistant with one of my professors from last year, and it's by semester. So I'm trying to debate if I should do it another semester or if I should just stop.
It depends on the person. It depends on the relationship. We'll talk after class.
Okay.
It depends. So if you have a good relationship with that person and you may not like their research very well, right? You either can communicate nicely to them that I would like to move into this area, if you have that area in mind, or you just want to build that relationship and do whatever. Okay, there's that. You just want to build that relationship just to make sure that you get these good recommendation letters, right? Okay, so it depends. Good question. Come on, I know you have questions. I can feel your brain work.
Well, this isn't really a question, but I agree with the research being a good way to connect with your professors, because we just talked about that in my Kimmy seminar, and they do research, and they said if you come talk to them and let them know you're interested, they'll, when they do get a research project, they'll let you know first, right? Because you're looking for something,
right?
And they'll tell you. So.
And with the research, there's a lot of things that comes out of it. There's some, you know, if you can get a publication out of that, which is excellent for going, moving, not just grad school, any getting a job, because that is a hard copy saying that you are doing something good, right? And it's actually very challenging, very tough to get a publication, especially as an undergraduate. But it also is something easy for me to write, right? So when I know, you're in my group, I can say you've been in my group, I can say exactly what you're doing, I know exactly what your skills are, right? And I can confirm that, right? And it really comes down to, it's just easier when you have the relationship, it makes it easier to write the recommendation letter. Or recommending you for these awards, so.
Let me just reiterate something. Bianca and I are more than happy to write letters for you guys. We will speak in great detail about who you are and what you're about and so on and so forth. But what faculty can write, particularly the things that Dr. Nelson has written on the board, it just carries so much more weight most of the time to those individuals who are reading those letters. It's imperative that you make these relationships, make these connections.
One reason why is very important is because I have seen the letters come in that other people have written, and so I know what is a successful letter and what is not. Does that make sense? So I've seen what a letter that looks, that's going to give you one of these, okay? Or give you a job. I know what it looks like, okay? And so I'm going to write your letter like that. I'm going to say you walk on water, if you do. If you don't walk on water, I can't say that, okay? But if you do, I will say it, okay? And I would say most professors would do that. When I say most professors, I'm talking about 90%. If you are good, it doesn't matter what it is, they're going to tell the truth.
What about follow-up, Dr. Nelson? After they get the first meeting in, do they just stop? Is one enough? Or do you want to see them more often?
There was a great question yesterday where the student was in that professor's class and they had a good relationship, right? And but they were like, okay, I don't know how to continue that, foster that relationship now that I'm not in that person's course. The best way to do that is you're gonna put together your resume, right, of what you're doing, and every 6 months, you're gonna send that resume to that professor and ask them, can you have a meeting to review the resume? For us, anytime you ask us to our advice, that makes us happy. Because we love to put red ink on things. We do. We love to put red ink, right? And don't worry about the red ink. It's only gonna make it better, right? Think about that. It's gonna make it better. So we love to put red ink. I don't know why. You know, we'll find a mistake in anything. I'm serious. We just will find a mistake. Yes.
So you're going for a professor that's not in your department, you should still go to them and look at you?
Yes, why not? I have people in Kimmy. I have people all over the place coming in. No, you should choose people that you believe have a similar relationship with that's on the same page. Yes, it doesn't matter if they're in your area or not.
So I think I struggle with identifying with people within my college and things like that. Things like what I want to do.
Me too.
So
you're not the only one. Go ahead.
But how do I wouldn't know how to foster a real relationship with somebody.
Now there's different types of relationships. I don't know. We don't have enough time to talk about really different types of relationships. Okay, so there's a relationship. You're my advisor, and I do work in your lab, and then I leave. Right. So that's a very very professional relationship. So I don't have time to go through all these things.
5 more minutes. Do what you can. We're sweating to death.
Can you look at that afterward and we'll talk a little bit about it? I know what you're saying.
That's a great question.
That's a really, really good question. That's a whole hour in itself.
Right, right. Yeah, that's a great topic to even.
That's a whole hour in itself. Mm-hmm.
How many of you feel like you've already developed a good relationship with at least one professor? What'd you do? Share your secrets.
And then she's helping out with trying to get scholarships, and she shared posts of me reaching out for help. Huh. So she's benefited me from just staying in touch.
Right. I'm not on Facebook, so you can't do that. Other people.
Yeah, that wasn't
shared.
I'm just a sociable person, so I just conversate with them. They're normal people. So just ask them how their lives are going. A lot of professors, since I'm psychology majors, a lot of my professors talk about their lives in my psych class.
So, okay. Yeah. Well, that's not, you're not going to get that in the art sciences. Yes. Most of them.
Sorry.
That's just, okay, look. I'm learning also, so, because there is some differences. Me coming from certain universities coming here is different. It's just different. So I'm really learning. Yes, ma'am.
Well, I'm a political science major, so my government class, me and my professor, I always stay after, and we just kind of talk about, GOPs and, just candidates and stuff like that, because it's interesting to us, to everybody else.
And that's the same thing. You found a link between the two interests, right? And so I tell you, if you find an interest, people will talk. They just will. They will open up.
That's a really good one too. Yeah. You know, that Dr. Nelson mentioned it early on in the workshop, finding that common ground, and it may be something like basketball, it may not even be related directly to that course at the time. You'll get to that topic for sure, but.
And I'm not saying going and forcing it, because we're not here to, you're not here to force relationships with people. You're, if that person is open, and you would know pretty quickly if that person is open to having some, even as slim as a professional relationship. I'm your professor, your student. I'm here to help you. That type of relationship, I would say that most of the people would like to have that type of relationship. They're interested in you being successful. Questions.
You said you were a OCHEM.
I am an organic. You're giving me that I don't like organic chemistry look. Okay, so I am a. I got my PhD in organic chemistry, and I am a OCHEM professor. I teach organic chemistry. Currently, I teach the survey course. I love it.
See, man.
Somebody has to.
Ryan has to love it. Somebody has to love it. And yes, most of the people do not like it. They say I'm okay, but the course is their course. But I'm part of the course, so then. So. Come on, you have a burning question. No, one more question. No? No more questions? What time is it?
It is 5:41.
Oh, man.
One more question and we'll wrap it up. Someone come up with a, there you go, Chance.
Well, earlier you said like any minority questions. So do you feel like it was harder for you as a minority to get to where you are now? Mm-hmm. Do you feel like you had to overcome a lot of obstacles and stuff?
I had a lot of help. I had a lot of mentors and mentors that didn't look like me because in my area, there isn't that many. There's some people that see a common ground, okay? And they say that this person, I see what this person wants to be, right? And even if I'm not giving them anything, these are what a real good mentor is. They willing to put you into an area, or put you into a place where with a little bit of pushing, and I had lots of pushing sometimes. So you need help. And finding those people, and sometimes they fall in your lap, are those people that are willing to pull people up. And sometimes they realize that in order for us to be, in order for us to succeed in certain areas, we need to make sure that everyone is involved. Everyone must be involved. You must have people with different environments, to different experiences, in order for us to really solve really, really critical solutions. And you have those people out there. So is it challenging? Yes. Can you do it? Yes. If from my experience, I took every remedial class at Francis Marion, my undergrad university, and I still graduated in 4 years. And it's because I worked hard. You know, I just had to work hard. And so people can't come up to me, I can't do it. I'll give you some, every time you come with something, I got something back. This is what I've done, so you can do it. You might need help. I'm not saying you don't need help, but you can do it.
Absolutely. And I love the idea of the 3 points, to get the one. You gotta try it 3 times. You gotta give the effort. Don't short step that.
And I think if you think about it, that you paid for this education, mm-hmm. at least someone paid for it, mm-hmm. okay? You should go after to get it.
Okay, so think about it like this. I have a professor, and I'm really struggling in the class because of just the way it's taught. He has office hours once a week. And if I give him 3 tries, that's 3 weeks. Midterms come out 6 weeks. So I mean, by then I'm.
See, you're already thinking negative. You got to think positive. Okay, so that's the. Yeah, I know it's hard. I know it's hard. So let's go back. So you have a professor, and you've been in their office.
Yeah.
Is this something we need to talk about afterwards? Okay, cool. Let's go. Okay, so. Tell me the parts again.
Like, okay, I went to office hours.
Yes, and now give me more details about office hours.
I went there and I was like, I'm just kind of really struggling. I don't.
With
like,
what?
With everything, because like literally we're.
No.
Everything.
You can't. No.
I told them, I'm like, I come to class, we do a practice problem.
That's very general, notes. Right?
Yeah.
So you come to me and say, I don't know anything.
I mean, I told
you. And no. Like, okay. What do you like? Tell me something you like.
Food.
You like food, okay. And I say that I don't like any food. The first thing you're gonna say, how is that possible? Because what you're saying to me is that I'm a terrible teacher. That's what you told me, right?
Yeah.
When you said I don't know anything, it's saying that I'm a terrible teacher.
Yes.
And you're off on a bad note.
You're salty.
Is that not right? I mean, think about it.
Yeah.
If you come to me and say, I don't understand anything, you said, because I've been teaching for 3 weeks, and you say you don't understand any of it, right? And you just told me that I'm a terrible teacher. Do you agree? Does anyone agree with that? Okay. Is that the right approach?
No.
No.
It is not.
But when I'm like,
No. Let's break it down so you can. We're here to get help.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay, what is the right approach here? Anyone? Because it has nothing to do with chemistry. This is everything. What's the right approach to approach a professor with something you're having a difficulty with?
Like
if you don't know.
Specific chapters.
Facebook? Okay.
Chapters.
When you say, I gotta do chemistry, I'm sorry. Okay, you have a going from. And then they go and explain A. Oh, now I understand where A come from. Now I don't understand where B come from.
No.
No. Saying that you don't understand anything, right? Right? And then you say, where did that arrow come from?
True.
Right?
Yeah.
But when you come in and say that, you didn't teach me anything. That's what you're saying to me. Yeah. And remember, we're human.
Yeah.
We have feelings. And I spend for a hour lecture, it takes me 5 hours to prepare. And you're coming to me and saying, no, listen, just listen. It takes me 5 hours to prepare 1 hour lecture,
yeah.
Right? And I came and I lectured for 1 hour that week. So how many lectures a week?
Two.
How many lectures a week?
One.
So how many hour lectures a week? Three, right?
Yeah.
It's 3 hours. So how many hours is that? That's 15 hours a week where I'm just preparing lectures. That's not me going in there and lecturing. Right? And you come to me and says, I don't understand anything. Does that make sense? Okay.
Yeah.
So it's their approach. It's their approach. Now if you go in there and say, you know, I have no idea where you got it. Where did it come from? And with this nice soft voice just like this. And then you go and you say, I have no idea where we come from. And then you say, I don't know where this came from. I bet you'll get more of the information. And one reason is that it won't go to the higher level because that person is going to have to bring it down. And if this is still not solving your problem, you shouldn't be only going to the professor. There's TAs that get paid, right? There's about 30 TAs. So someone should be to help. And if that's not the case, I'll get a grad student. One of my grad students to help. So you have to solve this problem first. You have to solve A equals B reaction. You solve something first. I'm sorry. Yeah, so I hope that helped and I got some other tips. So that's what you have to think when you go in there and say these types of things. We are human. We still have blood, we have feelings. And it can hurt our feelings. It really can. And then you're not going to get what you want. Remember, you want something. So you have to give some sugar to get what you want. It's okay. Ooh, it's hot.
That's wrong.
They did. Right? You want to talk about how you give sugar? Be kind. Be nice. We're still human. I know we look like robots and stuff, but we are. We have feelings.
All right, guys, let's give Dr. Nelson a round of applause. Transfer students.
Okay. So. Check us out. We do have money. No, you don't like money. What's your major?
Business.
And you?
My major in history.
History?
Construction management.
Unfortunately, neither one of those, and you're this STEM program, which is, of course, science, technology, engineering, and math. I'm sure you all know that by now. Do you know it used to be called SMET? Can you imagine, oh, I'm SMET program. Fortunately, they changed it to something a little bit more refined. I'm glad to hear that. So are you all seniors? You are juniors?
Mm-hmm.
Juniors? Well, now's the time to start thinking about graduate school. And graduate school is the next big step. You're kind of like grimacing over there. You want a job or just going
to go to work?
Ready to go to work? I understand that one, but come on in. The graduate school is extremely important. There's a lot of information about graduate school that I don't have anything for you.
Okay. Are you a freshman, sophomore?
Sophomore.
Okay, they're up in 219.
219? Okay.
Yes,
it's a, so you get to not have the boring.
That's okay.
All right. Cool. Oh, we were hoping you'd leave your skateboard, though.
Well, it's a 219 or 218? I hope I got the right
It's 119.
No,
or
it's
219, yeah.
That's
same room.
But anyway, graduate school is extremely important. I know you like going, why do I want to go to grad school? But grad school will get you to the next level in pay raises, the next level of meeting some goals and requirements. My husband is in construction and he has a master's degree. And believe me, there have been times that it's been important. So don't discredit it to go to work. It's always something out there, okay? That somebody's gonna say, ooh, you've got the master's, you've got a little extra education, let's move you into this management position or whatever. So anyway, what is the GRE? Everybody know what it stands for? It stands for the Graduate Record Exam. Unfortunately, it's the world-known exam. Why do we want it? We want it to get admission to grad school. It's a requirement for most programs. There are a few programs that don't require a GRE. If you think there might be any doubt in that, then you need to make sure you ask your program that you're applying to if there is a requirement for it. You're going to grad school too?
I'm already in.
Oh, you're already in?
Sort of. I got accepted, but I'm in what's called an accelerator program. I'm actually with him, but I'm attending classes online through Arizona State.
Oh, cool.
So I'm in their accelerated program. I'm working on the, this is my last semester. I graduate my bachelor's in December. When I graduate, I'll have completed 12 of my 30 credit hours I need for my master's program.
Oh,
also I'll be almost halfway through it.
Right. So did you have to take GRE or anything like that? No. That's pretty cool. Accelerated. More and more places are doing accelerated programs, which I think, are you a junior or senior?
Yes.
Okay, come on in. What's the password?
Please.
Okay.
How you all doing?
We're good. Now that we've been interrupted, you know, well, that's cool. A lot of programs are doing accelerated programs where people can do that if they're going into
it. Well, I mean, it works out really well. You're already a senior and take it, because it's only for the last semester of your classes that you can actually take it for. So it actually, in the long run, it saves both money and time because they count for both.
Mm-hmm.
So, not the easiest thing to do, however.
Oh, no, it's not. But I have to say, and maybe Mr. Ragoso will agree with me, I thought graduate school was so much more fun. It was easier. It was because I wanted to be there. Did you feel like it was a better option for you than undergrad?
Well, once you get into the actual research aspect of it and you're doing the focus that you enjoy, I thought it was great.
Yeah.
Sometimes undergrad is just too general and not necessarily the focus you're looking into.
I think I enjoyed the classes because everyone was there because they wanted to be. They wanted to learn. They wanted in this program area. It wasn't because mom and dad said you have to go to college. You can't go to college. You got the scholarship. Now you have to make these grades. You're there. You're paying for it, and you want to be there. So graduate school, to me, was awesome. And it's normally for your master's degree, it's like 30 credit hours. You think, oh, 30. It's really like 24, which is like two semesters if you do it correctly, because your thesis, which most programs are going to have some sort of a thesis requirement, is 6 hours typically. And that's the fun part of doing what you are needing to do. I did my master's in 11 months. I worked full time, and I had some children at home. My husband. I had two other children in college, but I did it in 11 months and worked full time. But my thesis was also my job. I got to start a new job, so I implemented new programs, and doing the research on how to implement new programs and things, they let that count. There are things that you can do at the graduate level that you could not do at an undergrad. But I did not have to take the GRE. But I administered the GRE. When several years ago, I was the director of the testing center here on campus, and GRE was strictly paper when we started out. You couldn't take it any other way. You met on specific Saturdays. You showed your ID outside the door. You came and you sat down in the room. Everything else got left in the hallway. And you took it on paper and pencil, and it took almost all day because you took the general test and then you took the subject test. Well, then part of my job was to implement the computer-based testing here on campus. So I got to start that, and that was pretty fun. And we were the first place, OSU was the first school in Oklahoma to have computerized GRE. And that's pretty amazing to think about that. But again, what? So you can take it. Where can you take it? How do you register for it? There's all these fun things about the GRE. You can take it here on campus at the OSU Testing Center. You can take it twice a day. Well, it's scheduled twice a day. You have to make an appointment, but you can only take it. Does anybody know how often you take the GRE?
Within 30 days of the last test.
Mm-hmm. How many times can you take it in your lifetime?
Oh,
or in a year? In a year?
Oh,
five times a year. It's $195, so if you want to whip out $195 to take it repeatedly, I guess that's your business, but I would do it the first time as well as I could. You can also take it in Oklahoma City and Tulsa. You can take it at Sylvan Learning Centers lots of times. Sometimes they're called a Prometric Center. I think you need to take it at a place that you feel most comfortable. If you felt more comfortable being at home, say you lived in Tulsa or Oklahoma City and you slept in your own bed at home and then went and took the test, that's probably a better situation than maybe taking it here if you live in the dorm and you just have to decide where's the best. I also recommend that you go prior to scheduling your appointment to the testing center and just take a look at it. They won't let you in the testing room, of course. They shouldn't let you in the testing room. But they may let you look through their windows or whatever their observation is. You can look at where their lockers are. You can kind of just get a feel of what it's like there. The day of the test, you can take nothing with you except your ID card. And it better be a good valid ID card. An OSU ID card does not count as valid. We had a young lady last week who showed up to take her GRE with her OSU ID. Does not have a driver's license. They wouldn't accept it. She had to forfeit her $195. That's pretty dang tough. With the new travel laws coming into Oklahoma starting in January, you're going to have a passport to travel anyway. Make sure you just take your passport. And for those of you that didn't know that, you need to be getting a passport because you can't fly in January without one from Oklahoma. Okay. New rules. Oklahoma didn't adhere to some law, and our driver's license are not considered valid IDs for TSA. Sometimes some states may be able to still use their driver's license, but right now Oklahoma's cannot.
Okay. So if I have like a Georgia's state license.
Let's hope they did the rule.
Okay.
We're hoping. So, but anyway, take a good ID with you. That's really important. You do not need to take pencils. You cannot take paper with you. You cannot take anything but your ID. Do not wear a coat. Do not wear scarves. Do not wear a hat. Do not wear anything else. They are actually going to give you paper. Typically, it's 6 sheets of paper, and they change the color every day, or they should change the color every day, so no one will have the same. They know what's going on. They should give you 2 sharpened pencils. Number 2s, mechanical pencils are not allowed in the room. Okay. They should have a locker that you can put anything in it that you need. I would probably bring some money for a soda. They may make you put it in their locker, but at least if they may check your pockets. Depends on how the testing center. I know when I was there, we checked pockets. So we didn't allow anything in the room at all. you allow mechanical pencils just because there could be answers hidden up inside. You have to be very cautious, and you can't allow, you could have a microphone in it. You could be reading off test questions to someone and act like you're reading to yourself, and they could be giving you the answers back. I mean, there's just all kinds of ways to cheat on the test, so.
People put as much effort they put into cheating as to study for it.
That's right. It would be nice. There was, many years ago, there was an ACT scam going on, and these kids were taking the ACT test in New York and marking their pencils, like A was a long mark, B was a sideways, C was a backslash, D was a forward slash, or whatever. And they could mark them on a pencil, and they then faxed those marks to California, which was taking it later in the day, same time, but later. And they were selling those for like $200 and $300 a pop. Well, the kids then would mark them on their pencils, and ACT let you take in your own pencils, so it looked like chew marks on your pencil. A little while for them to get caught, but so lots of cheating. There's lots of easy ways to cheat, and the testing centers, that's one reason they're so cautious about all this. So, but the computerized GRE, it's also computer adaptive. Does anybody know what computer adaptive is? Not really.
Is that more like depending on how you answer the question that make it harder or easier?
Yes. So it draws from a pool. It's kind of a, it is a form of computer-based testing that adapts to the examinee's ability and level. So it's going to start out with a medium question. This is kind of how I describe it. It's going to start with a medium knowledge question. Maybe like, what color is the ocean? It's blue. Okay, so you get this answer right, you're over here. But if you said the ocean is green, it's going to like, oh, I didn't know. So they're going to, it's going to come down and it's going to start pulling. It moved you down a notch. They're not quite as bright as we thought they are. What color is the sky? Orange or pink? Pink. Okay, let's go on down. Maybe come up. You know, so it's going to adapt you too. But you want to get the first five questions correct. You're only going to have about 47 questions anyway. So if you don't get the first five right, that can put you in that higher bracket of knowledge. That's the important part. It could be the one answer. It can put you in a different path altogether. So that's what computer adaptive testing does for you. It kind of tests your level of knowledge. Because the example that I actually wrote down is, if an examinee performs well on an item of intermediate difficulty, they will then be presented with a more difficult question, or if they perform poorly, they will be presented with a simpler question. So we don't want the simple questions. The hard questions carry more points. So that's one reason we have to do that. And why would we want to use computer adaptive testing anyway? It's more precise. It's a little bit easier than, I mean, it's the same answer. It's going to kind of help you know where you're at. I'm going to give you an example. My daughter, who's older, took the GRE. She walked in one day, and I am the test administrator, so she knew what the GRE was like. She knew the testing room. She knew the procedure. She said, I'm taking the GRE today. I said, what? That's back when it was $75, so it was a little cheap. But back then, $75 was hard to come by. So I said, well, you're going to study for it, correct? And she goes, nope, I'm going to take the GRE today. Okay, take it. I paid for it. She took the test, and she made three certain scores. She was a little bummed. It wasn't quite enough to get into the program she wanted to by just a few points. So I said, well, go home and study. Back then, and we have a different book. This is an older book, but I wanted to show you an example of, because somebody has my new book of how books you can get, and you can get CDs. There's online tests that are just crazy. So she got a book similar to this one, got a CD. She studied for about a month, obviously. Came back and took the test again. Again, she spent my money. She went up in one area and down in another, and her score stayed almost the same. So basically, she didn't actually gain a lot from studying. Well, she studied again for another month and took it one more time. Again, she spent my money. But she got the score she wanted or needed to get in. But again, her scores were still almost the same. So basically, computer adaptive is testing your knowledge. And it's just like the ACT. It's going to, you know, you can work and get it up, but basically, it's pretty much the same all the way around. So this computer adaptive will keep you there. Do you know what portions of the test there are? Do you know there are three portions to the exam? Okay, there's
verbal.
Verbal.
quantitative and a writing part.
A writing part. So in the verbal part, what's it going to include?
Reading.
Some
definitions.
And a lot of analogies, comparison words. It's 30 questions. You have 30 minutes. Okay. So you can't put a lot of thought into them, but they're going to be quick. It's quantitative. At what level of math is the quantitative testing you on?
High school
math. High school math. Geometry. Algebra. Nothing above high school, hardly at all. Oh, gotta refresh my high school math because it's been a while since I've done algebra.
What high school level though? Because when I was in high school, the level of math was a lot different than what high schoolers now are doing. Mm-hmm.
That's why you have to review, but it is definitely at the high school level. For the quantitative, you have a little bit longer. That's why you need your 6 sheets of scratch paper, most likely. It's 45 minutes long. It's only 28 questions. So you don't have very long, so you can do a little bit of math. Yeah, and remember, you're going to turn in those scores, the scrap paper, and they're going to count it. And make sure you can't tear it. If at the very end, if you write your scores down, write them in a corner so you can tear it off, and they watch you tear it off. Okay? That's usually acceptable. It was when I was over there. Okay, and then the analytical writing, you get 45 minutes to write your first essay and 30 minutes to write your second essay. So you're going to write 2. And then guess what? They're going to throw in a bonus section. And you're going to say, oh, I already did verbal. Well, you don't know which one they're scoring. So chances are, this is the first one. Answer the second one like it's that one. You don't have a clue which one they're going to score. So you want to make sure that you answer them both. One time when I was given the exam, a student did. He got up and came and said, I just did this section. I said, get back in there and do it again. Hurry, your time's running out, and you don't know which one they're scoring. And he was like, oh. Well, who knows which one he scored, because I didn't never see his scores. But you don't know, so just take it in stride that you're going to have usually a test section, and that's to see just kind of how everybody's doing. So you wanted, when you think of all this, you're going to take 2 sections, and then they'll give you like a 15-minute break. And then you'll go back in and do another section. Your writing maybe first, your verbal quantitative last. It just kind of depends on a lot of good stuff. So what do you think a good score might be? You might know?
180.
Oh. I guess, because that's way past the range. 170 is top score, okay? 170. Anything between 130 and 170 is a decent score. Top scores if you did verbal, 163 to 170. Quantitative, this doesn't give you much. These are top scores though, 165 to 170. So writing though is going to be scored on a scale of 1 to 6. So of course 5 to 6 is going to be your best score for writing. Competitive scores are going to be a little 158. Starting at 158 to 162 possibly, or quantitative 159 to 164, and writing about 4.5. So it doesn't give you much leeway in the writing. And remember, you're having to type your answers on the essay, so make sure, I know most of you know how to type now. Periods, capital letters, 3 paragraphs, just what you learned in college. You can BS through 3 paragraphs, an introduction, a body, and a conclusion. Usually you can do that. But anything below these scores, programs may only require that you have good scores, so 152 would be fine. But some may say, if you don't score at least a 160, we're not even going to look at your application. So you need to check with the program that you're applying for. I would think chemistry, physics would want a higher quantitative than they would verbal. And some scores want more verbal, and some want more written. It depends. And some of them want an overall of everything. So you just kind of have to look at all of them and find out what they want. And I already told you, it costs $195 now to take it. And how are you going to pay for it? It's kind of tough amount of money. But if you're an OCAMP scholar, we'll pay for it one time if you bring me your receipt. But unfortunately, you have to pay for it up front first. bring me a receipt, I'll reimburse you. I also know that OSU, if you go to financial aid and fill out the proper paperwork, that they will pay for it one time.
Oh, that's a good gift.
You can, and I would. And that's exactly what I would do. Or I would try them first and get a voucher, or get, at least get that process going and get a voucher from them. If you register for the GRE, you can change your appointment, but they're going to charge you $50 to change the time. You have to do it 5 days in advance, and you have to go through all this legwork. I wouldn't do it. I would make sure it's a day and time, unless I was just deathly sick, maybe in the hospital. Make it change. But definitely, you pay by credit card. Online, you register, and I would get a voucher anytime I could. What if you have a disability? What if you have your scores? What if you do all your testing through Student Disability Services?
They won't know.
So you need to make prior arrangements for special accommodations on the exam, and they definitely can do that. I'm going to use you for an example, if you don't mind. But they may need to find a table height taller for you. Yeah. So you would need to work through disability services, not necessarily through disability services here, but through the disabilities accommodations and whatever you require.
They extend the test time usually.
Extend the test time?
Mm-hmm. That takes you longer for writing and typing and everything mm-hmm. else. And
that's right.
The adjustable table and, yeah.
Whatever you need. They can do that. They can also, if you have to have a totally quiet environment, clear out the test center and you can be the only one in there, if that's what needs to be done. If you need a reader, because you have those functions, that can be supplied. The reader will just read the questions.
A lot of times they'll also supply it. When I took my ACT, I had them, because it was paid by the time mm-hmm. when I took it. And they supplied someone to write my answers for me. Which, of course, we had to do a completely silent room.
Exactly.
Where nobody else was in there. Mm-hmm. But they would have somebody in there, and I'd tell them what the answers were, and they'd write them.
And that could be the same way, depending on your disability. So don't think you can't take this standardized computer adaptive test if you have a disability. There are a lot of disabilities that are just readers, scribes, time and a half, because you need more time to process. And if you have a hint of a disability, go take care of it. Go to the Disability Services office on this campus and start using that now. It's nothing to be ashamed of. I used to read for a young man. I used to read for a soccer player. There are a football player, a wrestler. All these people, they read as well as I did, but they read it and they didn't hear it. It didn't comprehend. But if someone read it to them, they got it just like that. Lots of different things. So time and a half is a big deal. So if you think you might need more time on the test and you got a little bit of a disability, start working on it now, because I'm all for that kind of stuff.
I know one thing that I usually do is, because I'm kind of one of those people that I try my best to do it at the level that everybody else does it at, mm-hmm. but I make sure I have those accommodations mm-hmm. just in case I do need them, mm-hmm. especially usually with the time and a half. With being online, you know, sometimes I can get through the questions. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I can't.
Right.
But having that time and a half there gives me that extra protection.
That's right. And so I'm just putting that out there, guys. It's something I try to tell all students to do, and it's something you really, really need to think about. Can you still take this test on paper? You can. I probably wouldn't recommend it. Probably not very often, but some schools may require a subject exam, so you definitely want to check and see, does my school require a biology subject exam, or I don't even remember what they all are anymore. There's so few of them, it's just really difficult, and you wouldn't want to do that anyway. It must be good for Saturday. I went over the break time, what you can bring with you. Can you cancel your scores?
Yeah.
Still going to cost you $195. So, you know, is it worth it? I don't think so. I kind of like to see them and know what they are. Can you get them reinstated? Yeah, cost you more money. ETS is a big conglomeration of money. How many scores can you have sent to schools during your test?
Four. The one that you go to and three additional.
Mm-hmm. Four. And those are a four-digit number normally. Usually you have to type in a four-digit code for those schools, so you probably need to know them.
But okay. They let you search for them now.
Do they let you search for them?
System, yeah.
Okay. I couldn't find that online anywhere that told me about that, so I just know you used to have to know the numbers. But you can always get more score sheets if you decide you want to go to additional schools, but they're going to cost you about $50 a piece. So yeah, it's not much fun at all. So I used to be on an ETS dream team. We traveled around kind of doing this exact same thing to test it, to students, telling them how to take an ETS test and how to prepare. So it was kind of fun. I apologize, I don't have any PowerPoints to show you guys the fun stuff about the GRE. I think you kind of know what it's all about. It's going to get you into grad school. You understand the computer adaptiveness of it. The scores are important, checking with the people you're applying for. Those are the important things. Each graduate program has their own requirements. So you want to score what they want you to score in the areas that they think are most important. Those are the most important things. So what else do I have here? Some fun stuff. Let's see. Oh, if you had this, I never say this right, so, you know, I may have a bachelor's degree, but I don't read very well. Antonyms, is that how you say it? All right, palatable, let's see if we all get this one right. I had to look up the answer. Palatable is to culinary, odorous, unappetizing, unflavored, or bland.
Unappetizing, yeah. It's opposite, anti.
It is, it's C. Ah, Troy, you're going to grad school. Okay, let's do sentence completion. See, I hate those things. The remarkable fact that many inventions had their birth as toys suggests that people philosophize more freely when they know that their blank leads to no blank results. Cognition and trivial, persistent, satisfactory, speculation, weighty, creativity, measurable, conjecture, or inconsequential.
You may have to read
that. Yeah, the remarkable fact that many inventions had their birth as toys suggests that people philosophize more freely when they know that their blank leads to no blank results.
It was in
three days. These I should have had on the PowerPoint, I apologize. Yeah. Cognition, trivial, persistence, satisfactory, speculation, weighty, creativity, measurable, conjecture, inconsequential.
I'd say creativity, satisfactory. Yeah.
You're going to grad school too, see? You guys got it, yeah. See, it's not that hard of an exam. You just have to think about it. If you had seen that, you would have known it right off.
Yeah. I was excited to see it.
Yeah, it's hard when you do hear it. But there are people who do need to hear it and kind of look at it at the same time. So that these are online. There's a new site too that will send you a new question every day. Pop it up, can you answer this? It wouldn't hurt to just sign up for it, whether you're going to take the GRE or not. Think how smart it makes it, especially if you got to be on TV. Ooh, Trivial Pursuit, I'm thinking. Okay, what else do you need to know? There are all kinds of official guides. You can, ETS, Educational Testing Services, are out there to do all kinds of things for you on how you want to do it. I really think that you should take a practice test. OSU Ed2Go, it's not OSU, but there's a program called Ed2Go. It's an online test prep program you can take. It's $95, it lasts about 8 weeks. It's kind of self-paced, it's two lessons a week. It starts like every other month. It's a It's a good little program. It's not expensive. You can also do Kaplan. In fact, we're going to have Kaplan come and talk to us in a couple of weeks, but their test prep is about $400. So let's see, 95, 400. Does Kaplan teach you that much more? But they have the name behind them, and so they get. But if Kaplan offers a free practice exam, get your butt in the seat. I mean, get your rares in the seat, you know. That's important. Get every free practice exam that you can, and Kaplan does do free exams. Sometimes Kaplan has vouchers, too, so you want to make sure that you're always checking out that kind of stuff. Those are important things, and then I brought, let me find it. I did do a little work on this. I actually want to apologize to you that, and Bianca, that I totally forgot I was doing this.
No, that's okay. We understand. You just came off your symposium, so.
So, yeah, in case y'all didn't know, we did a research symposium Saturday, and we had over 200 people there, and it went off. I thought, did you think so?
Yeah.
Thank you. You better say yes.
Just because she gives you money.
So, first time it was ever on time all the way. Yeah. I mean, all the way. Pretty much. I saw some things we needed to change, some things we need to work out. But I thought we had dynamic speakers.
A lot of ice cream.
Good ice cream. I have some if you want to stop in and get some. So, anyway, the GRE has been around since 1949. I found that kind of interesting that it's been around for so long and hadn't changed a whole lot. Just gone from paper to computerized. But, used to, they had different kinds of scores and, So like prior, they had a high score of 800. So that's probably where you got your 180. And now it's 170, which is in the 99 percentile. So I did kind of print these out. I was surprised 500 was the low score. So there are people that still go, oh, I made an 800 on my GRE. Or your grandpa. You go, oh, wow, he's pretty smart. Or he'll say, I made a 500 on my GRE. You go, oh, that's why you did good grad school. So anyway, you can compare the scores to the old ones, but we want to go by all the new ones. But the GRE is extremely important.
Do you mind if I throw in a couple
things? Please, help me out.
I recently, I took the GRE about 3 years ago for a PhD program. And before then, I've taken it a total of three times. I took it two times prior to that. All computerized, never paper. Everybody thinks I'm like really old, but I'm really not. Old. Makes me feel bad whenever they. But no, just a couple of tips, guys. First and foremost, a lot of these resources we have inside the SSS Resource Center. So if you are about to take the GRE or want to start looking at the stuff, we have some stuff there in the office. We have a Kaplan book. We also have everything from ETS. And then we also have on those computers down there, we have the GRE prep, power prep on them installed as well. So just either get myself or Alyssa and we can sit down and work with you. The biggest thing with the GRE is Kay's right, there's only so much studying you can do. A lot of it is you either know it or you don't. And I mean, I'll be honest with you. The tips and tricks that I like to tell people in order to study for it, first of all, review your high school algebra and the geometry aspect of it. The math isn't like horrifically hard on it, but the problem is you forget all the little cheats and how to do it quick, so you waste a lot of time on those questions. So something that was simple for you back in 11th grade, now you haven't had practice with it. Most of us, especially if you're not a STEM major, the last time you took a math course was either freshman year or high school. So to try and remember how to do those things, it takes a while. So go back, look at some of those tips and tricks. That's a big benefit there. And there's always a way you can work the problem backwards. So if you don't know it, you can work it backwards. But unfortunately, you lose time there. So it's all about managing time when it comes to that. But definitely go back and learn all the tricks. A squared plus B squared equals C squared. Just simple rules and stuff like that. And the other thing about it, when it comes down to the verbal aspect of it, if you're able to take a Latin course before you
actually take, let's say you have an elective and you can take any level, Latin will help you. Always tell students, ETS will provide you with a list of all the words on the test for that act, for that calendar year. Unfortunately, it's several pages. You're not going to learn every single word in there. But kind of like what you guys did a while ago, the prefixes and the suffixes of words, those help. So if you know it's an opposite relationship, you're looking for a prefix that's going to give you something that's opposite. By, die, all those. Also knowing the root words, that actually helps you out a lot, and it'll help you with the verbal. I think that works a lot better than you trying to figure out every single word out there. The other thing is sometimes just learning the connotation of the statement. While whenever she was going through the ones that were blank, you got to understand the connotation. So even if you don't know the words, the answers that they provide you with, which I never knew any of them, as long as you know the connotation of the sentence, and then you're able to develop that same relationship on the bottom with the answers, you're able to do that. The GRE has changed a little bit in regards to the adaptive. It used to be you'd get one question at a time. So kind of like what Kay was saying, if you know, what color is the sky? If you got it wrong, you'd either get one of equal level or one of less level, and it was just the latter. Now what they've done is, because a lot of people complain about that type of formatting, now you have sections.
Yeah.
So now you can actually go up and down the section without having to go through each individual questions. But like Kay was saying, back in the previous test, the first five questions were the most important. Now it's the first section that you get. What it does, it will, whenever you take a section, let's say we're looking at the verbal aspect of it, you'll take two sections of it. And then there's a possible third one, which is the test questions. But the first section will sit you in a ladder, high, medium, low. So if you got every single question right in the first section and you got put into the high scale, you could miss every single question after that and you would score higher than someone who was on the low scale and then got every question right. So that very first section is very important. You have to make sure you do very well on it. So the first section places you in a scale, and then the second section scores you in a scale. Unfortunately, they always throw in a third section, either verbal or math. You don't know which one you're going to get extra. And then on top of that, you don't know if it was the second section or the third section that counted, as Kay was saying. So you gotta, even like, you know, Kay was saying, when you take that section, you've gotta take it as serious, even though you're on your third verbal section. So definitely, you have to take the test very serious. Now, what Kay was mentioning about take the test where you feel comfortable, that's important, guys. When I took it this last time, I took it in Oklahoma City instead of taking it here. First of all, it was the times that were offered here that I could get in. All the slots that were available were morning time slots. I'm not a morning person. I don't think very well in the morning. I'm grumpy in the morning, even to this day. Don't talk to me until I've had my coffee. So to me, the only afternoon time slots that I could get in were in Oklahoma City. So that's why I took it there. On top of that, it's a very long test. It's all about endurance. Like Kay was telling you, you can't take certain things into the testing area. But I always tell students, bring hard candy with you. And I always recommend Jolly Ranchers because it's enough of a little sugar rush, but not enough to crash you. So you'll get that break, like Kay was saying. They'll let you get into your locker, so if you got your wallet, they've got a soda machine, you can buy a soda or anything else that you have in there. What I always tell students, grab your Jolly Ranchers, to the restroom, pop in about three Jolly Ranchers, and then eat them before you start heading back. So eat them while you're in the restroom. Like I said, it gives you just enough, a little bit of a sugar rush, but not enough to burn you out. And then the other thing, she won't like it because she was a testing coordinator, testing director. I always tell students, sneak in Jolly Ranchers under your tongue because it'll give you something to kind of give you that second half of the test. You're sucking on that Jolly Rancher, still kind of giving you a little bit of, you know, brain juice, even though it's not really that, but you're getting a little bit of the sugar, and then it's also giving you something to take your mind off of what's going on, because it is a very long test. And trust me, by the end, you won't care. And you'll just see, be, whatever. And especially if, unfortunately, if you get to the point where you scored very low on that first section and the adaptive test part of it gives you a very weak second section, you'll know the answers will be very easy and it'll kill your self-worth and motivation. You'll be like, man, I'm doing bad on this test. And you'll keep
well, you
headed.
Could think, though, that you were extremely bright.
Yeah, but...
Wow, I know every answer.
Whenever you get at is to at farm, or at hill, as B is to what, and beehive is one of the answers, you kind of know. But I was a social science major, guys, so a lot of your hard sciences, like Ms. K was saying, they're going to look more as the solid score. A lot of your social sciences, they're gonna look at percentiles. So usually they'll look at, you know, some programs, the easier they are to get into, they'll look like at 50 percentile. And you're down right here.
I am. Yeah.
So like 50 percentile is 151. So this you're still high. And as you, if you're trying to get into some of these very competitive programs, those percentiles will go higher. So definitely, like Kay was telling you, you need to check with your program. Some programs will require the GRE. Some programs, without a very high score on the GRE, they won't care how well you did in your undergrad degree. So you definitely need to look at what the program requires. But guys, like I said earlier, if you're about to take the test, come by and see us. We'll definitely work with you. If you haven't talked to Kay about her program and you qualify for the program, definitely go and see her, because a lot of the other part of getting into grad school is having the resume to go along with it. They'll provide you some research experience at the undergraduate level and some mentor opportunities with some professors. And if you can get that good letter of recommendation from a professor who's a colleague with someone else at a graduate school you want to go to, that goes a long ways. When I graduated, I went to a regional school undergrad at West Texas A&M University. When I was there, we had about 7,100 students, or up to 8,000 now. So it's a small regional school compared to here. The grad program that I got into was at Texas Tech. When I was about a 3.5 student. My GRE score was not the greatest. I'm not a good test taker. But I was able to get a fellowship and an assistantship. My fellowship, they waived everything up to down to $1,500. I also got $1,200 a month, and then my fellow gave me $1,500 each semester. So everything that I made from my assistantship was take home. And what really got me to get those opportunities was that my advisor at the undergrad level was a co-writer with the grad advisor at Texas Tech. So he says, hey, I've got a really bright student for you down here, gonna send him your way, take care of him, and he took care of me. So definitely a program like K that pairs you up with people in your field goes a long ways, guys, so. But Kay, thank you very much for the information. Do you guys have any questions for us?
Once I finish my master's degree with the program I've got through ASU, they don't have a doctorate PhD program.
Okay.
So I was considering coming here for the PhD. Do you have to have the GRE for it in history?
I almost bet you do.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would bet you do.
There's very seldom PhD programs that aren't going to require it.
Right.
There's some that if you got everything through or it's a straight through program, they may not require it, but I'm more than likely that would take it. What program are you looking at?
History.
All right, okay.
Yeah.
Not regular history, right?
Regular history.
Okay.
No, my master's will be in North American.
That's
right.
And
I would think so.
Okay. The other thing is, I know that one of the disability things that I had is because I can't stay for long periods of time. Like with my ACT, they actually split it between two days.
They can do that too.
Can they still
yes,
do
they
that?
Can. Do like a section. You just got to go through all the accommodation paperwork to get that done.
Right.
And the testing center will have to do that.
That's definitely one advantage to taking the test here, is because they're more used to it than let's say,
that's right.
Books.
Sylvan or Pro-Metric. It's because they test the students with disability services in the testing center here, so they're used to working with them all the time. And so when they get a special accommodation, they know how to take care of them, which is, it's good. But I'm like you, you need to visit the testing center just to get a feel. And the first time I had a student do that, I thought, well, it's kind of weird, but I'm here every day. And they came in and walked around, and they actually came after the testing center hours so they could actually go in the room, sit down. Of course, I could accompanied them to make sure there was no hidden notes stuck under the table. And, you know, there's just all kinds of things. You have to be so cautious.
And they'll make you empty out of your pocket, because one of the biggest tricks now is people take two cell phones, mm-hmm. and they'll turn in one, and they'll go into their locker, and then they'll have another one. So they'll make you all empty out of your pockets.
You sign in, and you sign out. They used to thumbprint. Did they still thumbprint you?
Only when I signed in the first time, but not after that.
That's just part of it. You want to make sure.
Now they take it pretty seriously.
Very
how
serious.
Do I find out exactly about the jury for the graduate? Do I just go through the history department?
Go through the. It's right. Start. Mm-hmm. It should be online.
It should be on the website.
On the website. Mm-hmm. It should tell you what's required for admission to their PhD program.
Right. Probably some structure that was too. Mm-hmm.
And they may say, you know, you need the GRE and these scores. You need X number of letters of recommendation, examples of writing. There's just no telling.
But me, I had to, for the PhD program that I got into at UNT, University of North Texas, letter of intent, three recommendation letters from previous professors, and I had to submit my thesis.
Usually there's a goal statement, what you want to do, letter of intent's the same, sort of.
And what you want to do, you want to make sure that whenever you're writing out that statement, you include not the actual professor's name, but their research areas. Because one of the biggest things that's important about selecting a grad school is making sure that the faculty's research interest aligns with your research interests. Because they want to be able to pair you and have a mentor there for you who eventually will direct your dissertation. But if you don't, they don't have somebody there for you, if their interest doesn't align with your interests, then that's not going to be a good fit.
Okay. So with me having about a year, if everything goes well to finish my master's, should I go ahead and start now preparing things like the letters of recommendation and so on and so forth, or should I wait closer to it?
I would say if you're looking for like a fall admission for what, you would say 2018?
Well, I'll graduate in 2017 with my master's.
Okay. I would say fall 2017.
Well, no, wait. 2016, sorry.
Okay. I would definitely, the fall before the fall of your entrance. So usually, and even then, maybe spring.
A lot of grad schools won't take you in the spring.
Okay.
A lot of them do not. You have to start fall.
Previous spring before you. Mm-hmm. Now, most won't take you in the spring. Definitely very competitive programs will take you in the spring. And some will have the early admission, some will have late admissions. Usually the early admissions is if you want to be considered for funding.
Mm-hmm.
And usually those deadlines will be anywhere from November to December of the previous fall that you're looking to enter.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I just came from University of Iowa, and one of the things they had was they'll tell you how to apply there. And apparently some schools are on a rolling admission, so if they have enough people at a certain point, they won't even take the application. So if you apply by the actual deadline that you have on there, you most likely won't get it, credentials.
Definitely going to grad school, you want someone to pay for it. You don't want to have to pay for it out of pocket. You definitely don't want to do it on student loans. Student loans are nice if that's the only way you can go, but you definitely want to get it on someone else's dime.
Mm-hmm.
Or sometimes the cost of going to grad school doesn't outweigh what you're going to go in debt. Unfortunately, I did it the wrong way, and a lot of that, so I've got a lot of student debt. We won't talk about my student debt, because I'm going to be paying that money until the day I'm in,
you know,
in the grade.
And his student debt is nothing. I think my son-in-law owed like $600,000.
$600,000?
Yes.
Half a billion?
Yeah.
Do people make
half a
billion?
Half a billion.
Half a billion.
Half a mil.
With me?
Yeah.
Is he like an engineer?
He's like a doctor.
Okay. So
but, you know, still, you
Yeah, that's a lot.
My brother, he's a pharmacist. He just graduated. He ended up with about $30,000 more of debt, student debt loan, than I did. But the difference is he's going to be able to pay this off that I'm not. And that's just because of the field that I'm in. So someone like this young lady right here that's biochem and pharmacy, at the end of the day, is what aim are you going to take? Because a biochem is going to is going to pay a lot more than the poli sci side of it. And that's just the honest truth. But to be honest with you, at the end of the day, all that matters is about finding a career that you're happy with and you're going to be satisfied with. I always say whenever you see those statistics that say, you know, with a high school diploma, you're in this much. With a bachelor's degree, you're in this much, and so on and so. The numbers are accurate, but what they do is they take someone fresh out of college to someone who's retired, and they average out all the salaries in between. So it's not a realistic goal, because definitely someone at the end of their career is going to be making a lot more money than someone just coming out of college. But that's why you need to find a job that you love doing. I don't know if you guys got to see Stan Pearson when we brought him down a couple of years ago, but Stan would always say is what you want to do with life is find something that you really love to do and figure out a way to get paid for it. Definitely what Kay said at the beginning, don't say no to grad school, because grad school, getting that master's will put you above the rest. Even if you're in engineering, a lot of the engineering programs will, or engineering out of the industry will require that master's for you to get into management.
Definitely. And it's amazing, even in construction.
Yes.
And Galen's in road construction and demolition and stuff, and it has made...
They're talking about putting a master's program in, but they're still in the infant stage.
But you never know. You might want to look at something.
No, but they say the smartest way to go about it is if you're able to get a job right with your bachelor's, then most companies will basically pay for you to get your master's.
That happens a lot, and sometimes, but
yeah.
If you're already poor and you're used to being poor, go to grad school and then get rich. Because if you are poor and you get rich, typically you're not going to go back. Life is going to get in the way, and you're not going to, oh, I'll do it at night. No, because I got kids now, or my wife or spouse. I got to go to the school play. It's just too hard. I mean, to ask me, I know. I didn't go to college until I was 30. Two children at home, commuted to work every day, and I did it at night. There were days I thought I could never do this. I can't imagine.
In case you're right, guys, on that, and that's probably the biggest advice I can give you. It took me 4 years to finish a two-year program, and that's because I stopped out halfway through my program. And if you're thinking about going to grad school but you're not sure what in, let us help you figure that out. But have that mindset that you're going to go, because right now life is easy. Well, as easy as it can be. But life is easy in the sense of you have a routine. And it may not be the easiest routine by all means, but it's a routine and you're accustomed to it. Once you start making money, guys, you get other types of things. You spend a little bit more because you have more money. You get grown-up bills. You may buy that house that you've always wanted, buy a brand new car. It becomes more difficult to then go back to school. It also becomes more difficult to justify, you know, eating ramen noodles whenever you've been eating pretty good because of not being able to have that job. So it's a sacrifice, but just like you're sacrificing right now being in college and not out in the real world making money because it's going to pay out bigger at the end, same way with grad school.
If you don't go to, say you're 22 and you get your BS, and you go to grad school, it takes 2 years, you're going to be 24. Okay? If you don't go to grad school in 2 years, how old are you going to be?
24.
No matter what, you're going to be the age. You're aging up, so you might as well do something with it.
What advice could you give me? Because I have two young kids, and so my resume isn't that strong because I can't do student activities, I can't go and
do.
My resume is like pretty weak because I do have two small kids,
Yeah, she, and I don't know if you heard her, she said hers wasn't either at the time.
Mine wasn't either.
When I applied for my master's degree.
So
I didn't even have a resume. I haven't worked since I was 16.
I don't think student activities are that important. They're going to look at a lot of other stuff. They're going to look at, did you do, what's your degree program?
It's a health promotion and education.
Okay, so they're going to look at some of the other things. How, you know, your transcript, your health promotion. I don't even know what a health promotion person does.
It's like kind of like totally, it's like a basis for like physical therapy, athletic training, all of like kind of wellness.
But you don't have to be like in, I don't know, some student club. I mean, aren't you like in a health promotions club?
I mean, I don't have time to
But aren't you just even a member?
No, I'm not even a member.
Well, I think you can be a member and not be an active member.
Because I tried to last semester, but a lot of things happened.
I don't think you have to be an active member.
She's just basically finding something where you say you're, you know, maybe.
Part of it?
Yeah.
Yes.
And you'll do this.
I didn't know if that was allowed.
Well, I mean,
why wouldn't it be?
Even with us, I think you're part of SSS.
Okay, so
there's very few students that actually put it on their resume, but even showing that, because basically what you're showing the committee is that you've shown interest.
Okay.
It's a different type of involvement, but it's still an involvement.
Okay, because I thought I would have to focus more on the GRE to get like.
I don't think so. Do you? How old are your children?
My son's 1 and my girl's 4.
Okay, so do you do anything with them like at school? Is there a parent committee?
Well, see, I don't have the, because they always meet at like 1 and I have classes at 1. And I said if I didn't have those classes, then I would be there and I would like claim that. And I've been trying to figure out a way to go to her class and do volunteer time, because they take volunteer time from the parents. So I'm still trying to work on
there's
that.
There's a lot in that. But I think that they're going to look at your letter of application, they're going to look at your grades, what you're doing.
Definitely in your situation, I think what's going to be golden for you is being able to get a strong letter of recommendation from a professor.
Yeah, okay.
In your letter of intent or your goals, we're going to be able to sell that story that you've juggled being a non-traditional student in the sense of having 2 kids at home, going to school, and then still trying to make everything.
Are you a single parent?
No.
Okay. Well, that helps.
We
edit all
that. She's like,
right. You never know. But Jesus is right in the fact that you are going to. Here's my story. You know, I was 30 when I started college.
Yeah, see.
30. Okay. That's how I would start out my career. No one in my family went to college. I got married at 18. Fresh out of high school, I had 2 kids, and all of a sudden, I need a college education. How do I do this? What is that going to show the world? It's showing the world that, A, you've got a determination. You've got 2 kids that are doing well, and which you would say they're healthy, and they're learning, and they're not, you know, dirty. Whatever. I mean, how do you write it? I think you've got it.
You have a story to sell.
Okay.
It's just how you package it. And that's what everybody.
Okay.
And that's what I never always tell you guys is everybody's educational journey is different.
Okay.
And you can't compare yours to mine just like I can't compare mine to yours. Mm-hmm. But the way is to sell your story. Because that's going to tell a graduate search committee a lot different than my story did.
Okay.
So it's just how we package
it. And like here's an example. One of our students lived in town. She played softball all through school. I know we gotta go. All through school. But she would go on the weekends occasionally and visit with her grandparents on a farm. She wanted to be in animal science. Well, first off, she started her story. I visited my grandpa on his farm and I really liked it. So, you know, so then we reinvented more from the heart about going to grandpa's farm and how the cattle inspired her and da da da. It's just she took a whole different route and it was a word play. We got out the thesaurus and we looked and changed and you know what? She's working on a PhD in animal science at LSU now. Never lived on a farm in her life. Never. Probably never will, but she's so you know it's all in words.
Okay.
Yep.
But thank you guys for showing up, okay?
Thank you. And I apologize for not being more in the know at the GRE, but do it.
But definitely, guys, if you need help with it, we're there. Justin, Bianca, and like I said, usually when it comes to GRE stuff, Alyssa and I usually help in that area. So just you can set up an appointment with me through your coordinator, and I'll help you out with it, guys.
I'll be glad to look at your resumes. I looked at one today, and the young man said, what did you do to my resume? And I said, well, let's look here. I bet I had 100 marks on it. And there was nothing wrong with it. They were just inconsistent errors.
Yeah, it comes down to grammar, just the formatting. Kay's great at that. She definitely, she should have been an English teacher because she likes.
I like it. Red. No, but I mean, if I see where you have something one way this time and one way the next time, I will be consistent. You can be wrong in everything you do, but be consistently wrong. No one will know. It's always been my philosophy, and no one knows.
Guys, grab a bottle of water, grab some more chips and stuff. Thank you for coming again.
Yeah, I have chips, but you take it for steak.
And we have it.
Wait, what?
Yeah.
We have a sign in, we signed in before you got out to get credit. Oh, yeah, sorry, guys. One thing before you head out, because Bianco killed me in the evaluation. Yeah, sorry about that, man. We did have good. Sorry about that, guys. Because Bianco will kill me and she'll do it. Because then I'll ask her, where's the evaluation on that workshop? And then she's going to be like, oh, that's what you were on.
Are you doing this again tomorrow?
It might be there.
Oh, cool.
Yeah,
but,
I want to say
it's
really good.
It's
what?
eight
it's
years.
The same
but it's one of those like special comps.
So
I'll try and send you an email, but you don't hear from me. But then
I
shoot an email. And then I met with
their
students or but I have a volunteer program. So we're probably